What can be more unpredictable than an avalanche? A mass of water, saturated snow, moving rapidly over long distances, known as a slush flow. In Norway, such events happen regularly and sometimes cause mortalities. One of the most critical areas is the Finnmark county in the far north. Here, 55 slush flows have already been documented. One such incident occurred in May 2023, when the car of the county's avalanche planning expert, Trond Nilsen, came to a halt in front of a slush flow that had hit the road.
It took two of the cars from the parking lot and brought them down to 300 meters downstream. So it's big forces when slush avalanches happen. I took my drone up because I wanted to just have an overview of what happened. And I also was contacted by the police, and they asked me if I can go upstream to see if there was any danger of new avalanches. But I could establish that it was not any danger for more slush flows.
A major difference between avalanches and slush flows is how they start. Avalanches need a slope of 30 to 45 degrees. On these steep slopes, rainwater or snow melt drain easily, reducing the danger of a slush flow. For this reason, slush flows normally start at 30 degree slopes or even slopes as low as 5 degrees. As the water does not find an outlet, it saturates the snow. This can be seen as grey and blue coloured areas. Oversaturation leads to movement in the watery mass, which can initiate a slush flow.
Finnmark is a really big county. It's almost 48,000 square kilometers big. It has around 4,200 kilometers of roads. And the roads in this county is like the lifeline for people because it's almost the only way to get around. So it's really important the work the road authorities are doing to keep the roads open.
Closing the road in a landscape where the mountains meet the sea means a detour of between 4 to 9 hours. This has major consequences for commuters going to work and hospitals. There are also enormous losses to the regional fishing industry.
When we make assessment for avalanche danger, we have a lot of tools today to make avalanche forecasts and avalanche assessments. We don't have the same for slush flow because it's a lot we don't know about the process behind slush flows.
If the road authorities know when and where a slush flow is to be expected, they could minimize the losses. At the UIT Arctic University of Norway, a digital tool to map slush flow hazards is now in development under the IMPETUS project. Leading the research is Christopher Dambois, who has already helped develop a model for avalanche flow in Austria. Now he is adjusting the parameters of the same model for slush flows.
I'm currently in kind of validation mode. So I have the simulation working. I've come up with a method for automatically identifying potential release areas. And now I need to kind of make sure that the simulations actually match reality. So if we initiate a slush flow in a particular area, where might that hit?
If the slush flow hits a lake, it will overflow. It will gather mud and rubble on the way and hits roads and villages. Predicting these events will save lives through timely warnings.
I'm gonna simulate all of Finnmark and Troms County for a particular type of slush flow. And so I'll try to make the beginning of a hazard map for slush flows.
A hazard map shows the areas prone to danger from a slush flow. To predict when a slush flow can occur, a weather forecast is crucial. A forecast of extreme weather conditions such as heavy rain, high temperatures or wind shows the increasing levels of danger in a particular area. But weather is not the only fluctuating variable required for this calculation.
What's much more difficult and kind of nuanced is this middle level where you see some slush flows, but there is not this extreme weather. Slush flows occur anywhere there's a seasonal snowpack, but it just so happens that it seems like they're more common in Norway and Scandinavia than other parts in the world.
For slush flow formation, the The parameters that cause snow to melt are just as important as the weather conditions. These are influenced chiefly by Norway's location and history. In the Arctic, the midnight sun keeps solar radiation constant, even at night. As a result, warm nights allow water to accumulate in the snow. This contrasts with the Alps, where nighttime temperatures drop to or below freezing, giving water a chance to drain and lowering the snow's water content. While in the Alps, any residual water can also seep into its thick layer of soil. In the Norwegian mountains, however, there is only a thin layer of soil followed by bedrock, as the last ice age tore away most of the topsoil. As the water cannot refreeze nor penetrate the adjacent bedrock, it continues to accumulate. Warm periods and winter rain also contribute to water pooling, driven by weather approaching from the ocean. The most reliable data on unpredictable snowmelt, regardless of the weather conditions, is best gathered in the field.
Here in Tromsø, in the area, actually most of Norway is considered a maritime climate. A maritime snow climate can be summarized as like you expect to have thicker snow layers, a deeper snowpack, so more total snow.
A snowpack is the accumulation of snow that builds up over a season. These layers from winter 2023 to 24 each correspond to a past snowstorm. Evaluating a snowpack for wet snow hazards involves field tests that measure the water content of the snow.
In practice, everybody does this wet snow test. So if it's moist, you can make a snowball. If it's soaking, you can squeeze some water out. And if it's very wet, you can see water between the snow grains. And so that's how we classify it in the field.
These field tests for assessing the water content of snow are crucial for confirming the stability of a snowpack. One way a slush flow begins is when the water content in the bottom layer of a snowpack increases, causing the ice bonds to break, melt, and erode. The saturated water now acts as a lubricant. This weakened layer, known as the rotting bottom, breaks off and starts flowing downhill. This type of a release mechanism is called a crown failure. The water from the snowpack now has an outlet along the path of the slush flow. Although slush flows are unpredictable in time and place, Langfjord is a known hotspot for slush flows with a crown failure.
This slush flow path you see behind here, it starts on the top of the mountain and moves down in the gully down to the sea. And we know that it has a history of releasing three times. When we have mild temperatures, maybe 15 and above, the water, if it can't drain fast enough, it builds up pressure and it releases as a slush avalanche.
Today, the road that crosses the site of the slush flow leads over an embankment. This embankment replaces a bridge that used to be here. The force of the last slush flow in 2000 was so great that it uprooted the bridge and swept it into the sea. In field assessments, road authorities from Finnmark County collaborate with the UIT, the Arctic University of Norway, as part of the IMPETUS project. They systematically observe and document slush flow paths, uploading the data to the national database and updating information on potential release areas.
It's an important part of the research because we expect warmer and wetter winters up here in the Arctic. And so we expect more of this kind of wet snow hazard to come in. And wet snow hazard could be wet snow avalanches or also slush flows.
By using updated field data to validate their simulation model, the researchers aim to create a national hazard map for slush flows. If successful, this model could help protect lives and infrastructure in Scandinavia and other regions with a seasonal snowpack.